This is BBC Radio 4. And now the chief rock critic of the Times, Peter Perfides, begins a new series looking at great lost albums. This week he hears the fascinating story of Elton John's largely unknown sessions with the American soul producer, Tom Bell.
It was one of those improbable episodes that the pop charts throw up from time to time. The year was 2003, and dance floors across the country were ablaze with the sound of a strangely familiar voice. Are you ready? Are you ready for love? Yes, I am. Elton John was riding high with Are You Ready for Love, a song he had released almost 25 years previously to almost universal indifference. If it sounded quite unlike any Elton John song we'd heard before, that's because it was born of unusual circumstances. What most people didn't know was that there was the best part of an album where that came from. To tell the story of Elton John's Tom Bell sessions, we first need to reverse back down the yellow brick road to happier times for Elton. She packed my bags last night, pre-flight.
Zero out. Initially, from the year 1970 to 75, when that was that golden era for me, and the momentum was pushing me to greater heights, and 17 albums, different singles, you know, and it was just a complete, like, rocket ship to the moon. I could do no wrong, and it was all instinctive. I was a 20-year-old living my teenage years in my 20s. I miss the earth so
much. I miss my wife. There were just an explosion of ideas going on at that ideas, not only with music, with visual arts, with clothes, with everything. It was just the most exciting era. You could buy at least 10 to 15 great albums a week and be inspired. We were listening to bass sounds, drum sounds, piano sounds, things that were happening technically on records, and just filled with wonder. They were magical times. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time. Touchdown brings me round and get to fight. I'm not the man they think I am at home. Oh, no, no, no. I'm a rocket man. Rocket man.
But being a superstar in such magical times must, to put it mildly, have been a little weird. In LA, one radio station billed itself as your number one Elton John station. Over in New York, another radio station called itself your official Elton John spot on the dial. Here's David Buckley, author of Elton John, A Biography.
In 1975, he's the biggest superstar in the world. He's taken over from the Beatles. He's now it. He's dressed in that fantastic outfit of his.
I got outrageous. I mean, it was just getting out of hand. I mean, wearing hats on stage that actually sort of weighed half a hundredweight, and I'd struggle through funeral for a friend and Love Lies Bleeding, and then have to be taken to the side of the stage and have this hat lifted from my head. So, I mean, it was getting to ridiculous proportions, but I sort of enjoy it.
Undoubtedly, the apex of Elton mania came in California 1975. On the same day that the city of Los Angeles declared it Elton John Day, a special Elton John induction gala saw the singer chauffeured in a glittering golf cart to Hollywood Boulevard, where his new star awaited him. 2 days later, Elton played the first of two sold-out nights in front of 110,000 fans at LA Dodgers Stadium. David Buckley.
It's just a completely commanding performance, and that really was the high point of his career, I think.
What an amazing week. I mean, people do forget now, people know that Elton John is a superstar, but people forget just how very huge he was.
I believe around about 1974-75, 2% of all records sold globally were Elton John records. I mean, you just couldn't imagine that now. Used to charter the same airplane that Led Zeppelin used to use.
Right.
And it was sort of like a little community, wasn't it? There was a piano, there was places to sleep, there was places to take drugs, and apparently Kiki D told me that there was little vitamin bottles on the bar, you know, so you'd help yourself to your vitamins and that kind of thing.
Wow. It was perhaps no accident that Elton's 1975 album Captain Fantastic and the Brown Dirt Cowboy was a nostalgic concept album about the days when he and Bernie Taupin were struggling unknowns. It was almost as though he wanted to go back there.
If I pass wind, it's national news. It's ridiculous. It's a phase that the papers go through. They pick on somebody. And at the moment, they're really picking on me. And I can't do anything about it. It's a bit of an embarrassment because I'm sure people really think that I go out to get this publicity, and I don't.
Elton began to rely increasingly on drugs as a means of sustaining him through an unsustainable situation.
Things became less innocent, less instinctive, less fun. And then it became, what am I going to wear next to? What am I? It wasn't so much fun after that. And you can never reclaim those five innocent years.
Muggy nights, curtains drawn in the little room downstairs.
I just wanted to be one of the gang, I suppose. And it was fun, it was great. I actually thought, well, now I've done it all, I'm experiencing everything, and this is what it's all about. But consequently, one took it too far. It seems to be part of my makeup. I can't do anything by halves. I was fueled by illegal substances.
Someone saved my life tonight. Sugar Bear.
Sugar Bear.
Almost had your hooks in me.
It was time to retreat. Elton did the unthinkable and stopped writing with his long-serving lyricist, Bernie Taupin. He came off the road and pondered a range of options, which included buying a fourth division football club and getting some new hair. It was during this time he befriended a relatively unknown British songwriter, Gary Osborne, who had previously penned Amoureuse for Kiki D.
We just hung out as mates. We would go to his house, we played cards, we played backgammon, we watched the telly. He seemed very happy, he was optimistic. We did just all the kind of things the regular mates do, you know, and having a good time, you know, because he had been on a treadmill. He disbanded the band, he had no plans for recording. He said, I'm just going to concentrate on Watford Football Club and Rocket Records. I'm going to produce Kiki and I'm going to take a break. Now, of course, it's great if you're a multi-millionaire rock star, but it ain't so good if you're a millionaire rock star's manager, because you're managing a guy who isn't earning anything anymore. So there was pressure from John Reid, who was managing at the time, for him to do something. And John, I think, saw Elton's friendship with me as a way of getting Elton back into the studio.
For Gary Osborne, though, the idea of following a songwriting partnership that had shifted over 30 million records in 5 years was just a touch daunting.
He had only ever worked with Bernie. It was a very big thing, writing anything with Elton and not being Bernie Taupin. And I was kind of nervous about it. So when he used to say, oh, we'll write together one day, I would say, yeah, well, if that happens, that's fine.
I really loved Bernie as a person. He was my soulmate. I mean, there've been things that pull you apart, marriages, distance, you know, fame, all those kind of pressures on a relationship. I thought it would always last because I never dreamt of not having Bernie in my life.
After 11 albums in 7 years, Elton John couldn't stop if he wanted to. Finally, the idea suggested by Elton's manager, John Reid, came to fruition all by itself.
I believe it was the day of the Queen's Silver Jubilee. Elton came over to a place that we lived in Hampstead at the time. We had some beautiful red wine, the most expensive wine I had ever seen, Mouton something or other. And we have a great big grand piano, which was left over from when my father had the house. And he was playing around and he said, listen to this. And he just played a tune to me. And I said, well, that's lovely, that's gorgeous. He said, you fancy writing a lyric to it? I said, well, hold on, what would Bernie say about that? He said, oh, I've played it to Bernie and he hasn't been able to come up with anything on it. I said, well, just play it again. And when he played it again, I put it down on a cassette. And when he left at about 2 a.m, I immediately got my notebook out and got the cassette back out and started to see if I could get a few ideas going on it.
I was writing with Gary Osborne, he was writing with Alice Cooper and various other projects, and I'm sure even though that we were quite hurt by it at the time and a little jealous of each other, we never actually challenged each other and never spoke to each other about it, because I think in a relationship that's so creative, you cannot dictate to someone and say, listen, you can only write with me.
Oh, my love, I have cursed the stars above that led my heart to you.
Next time we got together, which was 2 or 3 weeks later, I said, oh, I've got a lyric for that tune of yours. And he liked it, and he would start playing the wrong tune. I said, no, that's not the way the tune goes. And I've got the cassette here, I can prove the way the tune goes, you know.
And the stars still shine on through.
there was an awful lot of to-ing and fro-ing between us. Whereas with Bernie and Elton, Bernie gives him a lyric and Elton goes off and he does it. And often the next time Bernie hears it is when he's got the record delivered, you know. Then he booked some studio time and we went in and did a demo. And I actually kind of expected that that would be the end of my writing with Elton. I mean, what a wonderful thing to have on my CV. I wrote a song with Elton John.
But the truth still shines on through.
Though Gary Osborne didn't know it at the time, Elton was already planning his next move, a move that set into action an album that was to barely see the light of day. The notion that Elton John's next project might be based in rhythm and blues was perhaps not as far-fetched as it might seem. As a jobbing session musician in the late 60s, playing on budget-priced hits albums, he'd already turned in surprisingly passable imitations of soul and reggae luminaries. That's his voice telling us how great it is to be
young, gifted and black.
In 1977, few producers around the world had a hit-making pedigree to rival that of Elton John. But Tom Bell, architect of the yearning, string-laden sound of his hometown, Philadelphia, was more than a match. After 8 years of uninterrupted success with the Delphonics, the Stylistics, and the Detroit Spinners, Tom was ready for a new challenge.
If I could, I'd like to be a great big movie star.
Rob took off one direction, he took off another direction, and we wound up as integers.
So what happened? Did Elton call you up?
Yeah, someone called me, and I liked the idea, so I sat down. Well, let me sit with the person. I know what he sounds like, but what does he sound like? I know what someone else wants him to sound like, but let me hear what I hear.
And you were, at the time, you were both at the absolute peak of your profession. So it must have been a pretty mind-blowing proposition to everyone around you.
Oh, yeah, it was fun. I always do oddball things, the things that most people won't do, I will do. You say, well, you're black and you can't do an Elton John, why not? What does the hue of the skin have to do with creativity? Nothing.
You had a bit of a trademark sound, these fantastically lush orchestrated strings. That in itself was quite a controversial thing to do, because there was a lot of debate over what contributed an authentically soulful sound, and some commentators thought that it was softening soul music too much. Do you remember that debate?
Oh, yeah. All of a sudden we have these authoritative individuals that know about, oh, yes, well, it's those strings and those oboes and the bassoons and the French horns.
So in a way, it must have been quite amusing to just annoy those people even more by working with a rock singer, a white rock singer like Elton.
Sure did. I always love when someone says I can't do something, I love it.
I'm a huge rhythm and blues fan.
Yeah.
You know, I grew up in a band playing that kind of music, starting out with the blues, then to rhythm and blues, Motown, whatever. So, unlike most musicians from England at that time, black music was our one love. Even Elvis Presley's music came from, you know, the blues and rockabilly and stuff. It was a mixture. And soul is not so far away from country. They're very much intertwined.
Did he strike you as a kind of happy kind of guy at the time?
Oh, yeah. In fact, we did a lot of playing table tennis for the first day or so.
So just getting comfortable with each other.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You find other things that go with your grain and the things that go against the grain. And so we found out through table tennis.
Were you both about equal? Was one better than the other?
Oh, we were equal.
I sense a diplomatic response there.
But no, it's just that he and I are both tenacious, and neither one wants to lose.
A lot of biographical accounts say that Elton was pretty burnt out. He was making two albums a year at that point, and maybe that informed his decision to let someone else take control for a while.
I think so. I think what he was tired, and he was smart enough to say, listen, man, I'm tired. Man, forget about this. I am tired, and I'm going to get someone else to do it for me this time.
Here's Elton in 1976.
The worst thing, like in Barbados, sitting on the beach for 6 hours and people coming to you every 15 minutes and saying, can we have a photograph? And you say no, and they say, well, why not? And I said, well, I'll sign you an autograph, don't mind that, but photographs, and I'd be posing all day. And they said, well, this is, we made you what you are, you've got to pose for a photograph. I said, no, I'm not, and I get into terrible arguments. It sort of depresses me. I'm fed up with being a public figure. I just want to get back on the road.
Mama don't want you, Daddy don't need you. Give it up, baby, baby. Mama can't buy you love.
Did he really give over all control to you? Was he just like a passenger in this?
Yes, he was. I couldn't believe it. I kept saying, man, are you sure that you want to do this? Are you positive? Because we don't want to get in the midstream and all of a sudden you have these great ideas and then you start, I hear it one way, you hear it the other way, then you're going to have problems. And I kept asking him to make sure, and he stuck to his word.
So no ego trip, no star trip.
No, he stuck right to his word.
Well, it must have been like a holiday for him. It was probably the nearest he could get to a holiday, given how hard he was working.
No, I think you're right, because he really didn't have to do anything but sing. That's all you have to do is say.
Mama don't want you, Daddy don't want you.
I guess everyone you work with has to be your muse in a way. And did that extend to Elton too?
Well, the artist and their voice is what tells me what to do. I don't tell it what to do, it tells me what to do.
Right.
And I heard melodies in my mind, the way he phrases, and also he's being English. He says words differently. There are some artists who have a high sibilance in their voices. There are some that have overbites in their teeth. There are some that have underbites. There are some who sing through the nose. Some sing through the throat. And when I heard his voice, it gives you the secret.
I think at that point in his career, a lot of people might not have thought of Elton John as being a soul singer.
Well, if a good artist can sing anything.
Give it up, baby, baby. Mama can't buy you love. Mama don't want you. Daddy.
With the songs sketched out, they went to Philadelphia to record the strings and Seattle to do the drums, where Tom Bell also freighted alumni from the Stylistics and horn section MFSB. Not to mention preternaturally funky bassist Bob Babbitt.
There's this big white guy, man, with this, I mean, this guy's big. His name's Bob Babbitt. He's a big guy. He was about 300 pounds and about 6 feet four. And no one could believe, first, that he was white,
yeah,
and two, that he could play like this.
It sounds like a human shock absorber.
That's exactly right. And it was time for Elton. Got the same guys, but only this time we added one or two guys. We added Leroy on guitar.
Right.
Because he also was being the writer. He played certain things that no one else could play.
The Leroy in question was Tom's nephew, who was just cutting his teeth as a songwriter.
You know, he was a superstar at the time, so I was expecting a little more of an attitude, and he was a very pleasant guy to be around. I think everybody was excited to work on the project. Everybody got along really well, so it was kind of a merges of two worlds, you know, kind of colliding, but with a lot of excitement.
I think one of my favourite songs up from the sessions is Three Way Love Affair,
mm-hmm,
which has got a lovely kind of orchestrated, classy pop. It's a great pop song, I think.
Oh, I remember liking that song a lot when we wrote it. Just thinking back that we wanted something real pop and danceable, you know, at the same time. So as writers, you know, we just try to come up with a melody and lyrics that you imagine Elton's voice on it. And coming up with that lyric, you know, three-way love affair.
There won't be any making up. I'm shaking this three-way love affair.
What do you remember of Are You Ready for Love?
You know, I was thinking kind of along the lines of stuff that we had done previously and also stuff that Elton had done, like with Philadelphia Freedom. I think he was emulating the Tom Bell sound at that point, which he did a nice job on, I thought.
Yeah.
Philadelphia Freedom was one of my favorite songs that he did, actually.
Catch a star if you can. Wish for something special. Let it be me. My love is free.
With six songs in the bag, an enthused Elton flew to London and invited Tom back with him.
He took me to a soccer match. You're going, you call it football. Over there, fantastic, a fantastic game.
Was it Watford?
I believe it was.
Because when he was recording these songs, he would have just been buying it.
That's what it was happening. He was buying it or beginning to buy it or had bought it.
Did he ask your advice? Do you think I should buy this soccer club? Is this the right way for me to go?
No. If he did, he picked the wrong man.
When the album came to briefly appear, well, it wasn't a full album. It was six tracks. Well, surely there must have been more than six songs.
No, there were only six.
Why wasn't the album completed?
Well, it was an experiment, actually, to see how it would go, and it came out fantastic. But I don't know what happened. I think his schedule got turned around. Something happened, which was out of my control. I don't know what happened.
But as far as you know, was Elton happy with the material?
I thought he was. He was tickled with it.
Lyricist Gary Osborne also liked what Tom had done with this track.
Yeah, I love it. Actually, I love it. He made it looser and he made it funkier. And it's not a funky song. It's an Elton John ballad, so it's not born to be funky. But Tom Bell is born to be funky and he doesn't know any other way.
A few months later, what might well have been the most inarguably American production of Elton's career was set to receive a peculiarly English premiere on the 1977 Morecambe and Wise Christmas show.
He spent the whole program going from studio to studio saying, is this where the Morecambe and Wise show is? And getting fobbed off. He would be guided to another room where Kenneth Kendall was reading the news, and he was guided to another room where he had a sheer drop into a canal. And then the show finished and the credits rolled and he hadn't done the song. And I thought that the ground might as well open up and swallow me, because everybody in the entire world had been told my song was on this show, and it wasn't. The most disappointing moment of my entire life. And then, after the show finished, they cut to two cleaning ladies cleaning up the studio, and of course it was Morecambe and Wise in drag. And Elton comes in, and he says, where's Morecambe and Wise? I'm supposed to be on their show. And they said, you've missed it. He says, well, that's very disappointing. I was going to sing a new song. So he sat down and played the song. And he finished, he said, that was what I was going to play on the Morecambe and Wise show. And Eric Morecambe said, it's a good job you didn't.
All that remained was to record three or four more songs for the album.
I believe there was a second session planned for early 1978.
Right.
Which Elton cancelled. I think it's very interesting, the fact that Are You Ready for Love? Elton had a lot of problems with that song, I believe. He wasn't happy with the mix and asked for it to be remixed about 18 months later by Clive Franks, somebody who worked with in a production capacity at the time, a guy who's actually still doing his live sound now, Clive is. Right. And when the single came out in 79, and I think reached number 42 in the charts, let's face it, it was a flop single.
A flop single, albeit mitigated by a brave decision to release it on the pricier new 12-inch format. Nevertheless, the song's underwhelming sales seemed to draw a line between Elton John and the Tom Bell sessions. With the disco backlash in full swing, Elton sought sanctuary on safer MOR ground, whilst Tom Bell took back Are You Ready for Love and gave it to the Detroit Spinners.
Was going through a period where he'd announced that he was gay or bisexual, as he put it at the time, which affected him in the middle of America, and that reflected itself in sales and in airplay. And David Geffen thought maybe the thing to do was to just try to go back to the old team. That seems quite a logical idea, actually.
Further collaborations between Elton and Gary Osborne spawned an album, A Single Man, but with chart action scarce, Elton John's record sales went into a decline that was only arrested when Elton and Bernie properly reunited for 1983's Too Low for Zero.
There have been difficult passages when we've disagreed with each other's lifestyles and behaviour and, you know, the drugs and everything like that. But our friendship is much, much stronger than that. And it's not a friendship. It's a kind of a love affair between two people that never slept with each other, because that never occurred and that never would have occurred. But it's that strong.
The first Gary Osborne heard about Elton and Bernie's reunion was when he opened up the newspaper.
It would have been nicer to have heard it from him rather than reading it in a newspaper. I didn't see it coming at that stage, the end for me there. But of course I was hurt, I was upset. But if that's the worst thing he ever did to me, then it's not so bad, is it? Because he's shone a light on my life that is still there to this day.
If the original 12-inch of Are You Ready for Love was too expensive to give Elton a hit, the ensuing 25 years saw it appreciate well in excess of inflation. By 2003, it had become a fail-safe floor filler in UK clubs, and DJs were paying upwards of £100 for it. Sensing that its time was finally nigh, Fatboy Slim licensed the track for reissue on his Southern Fried label. It entered the charts at number one.
When it was reissued in 2003, it just sounded fantastic. I think it just sounded fantastic myself.
Maybe better.
Better. I'll write a symphony just for you and me. If you let me love you, I'll paint a masterpiece just for you to see. If you let me love you, let me love you. Are you ready? Are you ready for love? Yes, I am. Are you? Are you ready?
When did you hear that Are You Ready for Love had become a hit?
When the radio station something called me and told me. Then Elton called me and told me.
What did Elton say?
He was elated over the fact that he said we were we were a little early, weren't we? I said, yeah, I think we were. About 25 years early.
As well, he might laugh. In the great words of Homer Simpson, it's funny because it's true. The pop climate of the past few years has seen Scissor Sisters going supernova by tailoring a 70s Elton-influenced sound to the dance floor. Punk's Year Zero dictum has been supplanted by a less tribal, more open-hearted aesthetic, as typified by the massively successful Guilty Pleasures Club franchise. In this world, the Tom Bell Sessions stand shoulder to shoulder alongside classics by the likes of the Bee Gees and Hall & Oates as blue-eyed soul of the first order.
I'm quite proud of it. And it led to 5 years that were just incredible.
What was more impressive to me was the ability to turn the reins over to someone else who he doesn't really know. It took some balls, man.
It was just great having a number one single, and I didn't really have to write it. I'm so glad for Tom Bell because I really enjoyed doing those six tracks with him, and I love those tracks, and they still sound great now.
So if he calls you up tomorrow and says, should we do four more songs to finish the album, what will you say?
I'd have a ball.
Okay, good.
I'd do it so fast, make it sense. I'd be there and knocking on this front door. We would have ourselves a good time.
You'd write it on the plane.
Yeah. Elton John's Tom Bell Sessions was this week's lost album. The programme was presented by The Times' chief rock critic, Peter Perfidas, and produced by Laura...